All right, so today we are going to look at some different logic families. Okay. What I mean by that is, so far all the circuit implementations that we have looked at have been considering the so-called pure static schema, right? Where there is a pull-up network and a pull-down network. The pull-up network is composed of CMOS transistors. The pull-down network is composed of NMOS transistors. And the two networks are dual of each other. So at any given time, exactly one of them is going to be on. Okay? Now, what that means is that, let's just look at what a CMOS inverter looks like. The voltage transfer characteristics look something like this. When the input is low, the PMOS is on, NMOS is off. And when the input is high, the opposite happens. Now, one question we can ask ourselves at this point is, can this circuit be slightly simplified? Do I need these two transistors or can I do something else? Okay? And one thing that you can see over here is, for example, instead of having these two transistors, perhaps I could make do with another circuit which looks like this. So the question is, what does this do, how does it behave, and how does it essentially help us to replace the CMOS with a resistor? Okay. Does this still continue to work like an inverter? Are there any conditions under which it will work as an inverter? Is this better or worse in any way than the previous circuit? Okay. So the first question, is this still an inverter? How does it behave? What happens when the input is low, or rather the input is high? Let's consider the input low case first. What will happen when the input is low? What will be the condition of the NMOS? Which region of operation? It will be cut off, right? So anything below threshold voltage of the NMOS, and the NMOS is going to be cut off. Cut off meaning no current is going to flow through it. If no current flows through the NMOS, then what is the current flowing through the resistor? Also zero, right? Because there is no load. If at all there is a load that's connected to it, that's also going to be the input gate of some other transistor, which means it's a insulator, no static current. Okay. So when the input is low, there is no current flowing through the resistor. If I is zero, the R into I drop across it is zero, so the voltage at zero is VDD itself. Now what happens, how does this behave? Unlike the CMOS circuit, this is sort of easier to analyze because all you have to do is slowly increase the input voltage. There is only one transistor whose region of operation you need to understand. And as long as you can keep track of that, you know what the final output is going to be. Okay? So when does the first change happen as I increase the input voltage? When I cross VT, right? So as I cross the threshold voltage of the NMOS transistor, what will happen? Which region of operation does it go to? Saturation. Why? Because the VGS, right, the VI has just gone above VT. So VGS minus VT is going to be the minimum among those three quantities. VDS of course is large, VO, right, which is close to VDD. So it goes into saturation, meaning that some current starts flowing. Okay? The moment current starts flowing through the resistor, what happens to VO? It drops. So I start seeing a drop in VA. As I go further still, I increase the input voltage still further, What's the next transition I'm likely to see? Region of operation. Most likely when the input voltage goes sufficiently high, assuming that the output has not dropped a lot, what region of operation will I go into? Velocity saturation, right? So it depends. Velocity saturation may or may not happen. Then it depends on the exact conditions, you'll have to work it out and see whether it does or not. But it's a possibility. So somewhere around here you might go into velocity saturation. But very soon after that, this drops even further. At this point, what region of operation are we in? VDS has now become small. Okay, so out of the three quantities, VDS is going to be the smallest of the lot, which means it's in the linear region. Now, once it's reached the linear region, okay, some current is flowing through, depending on, you know, the VI, the VDS, that is VO, and of course the resistor value itself. Why the resistor value? Because whatever current flows through the NMOS is also the same current that's going to flow through the resistor. Okay? So some R into I drop is going to happen across the resistor and that is going to determine my VO. Okay? So a combination of those is what is going to happen. What happens when the input voltage becomes high? That is, let's say it becomes close to VDD itself. What will be the condition? The NMOS transistor has a high VGS, a low value of VDS, because the output would have presumably dropped to a fairly low quantity. So it's in the linear region, current is flowing through it. Okay? But that current is also flowing through the NMOS, through the resistor. Okay? So there is a R into I drop across the resistor. Finally, will the output voltage go to zero or will it go to some other value? Think about what's happening over here. There's some current. The same current is flowing through the resistor as well as the drain to source of the NMOS. Okay? If that current goes to zero, that's the only possibility under which the VO becomes equal to zero. And the only way for the current to become zero is that the VO becomes zero. But if the current becomes zero, it means that the drop across the resistor is zero, so something is going wrong there. Right? So instead what we have is, this will go and settle at some value out there. Okay. In terms of what we define for the noise margin, what is this final value? What is the term that we use for describing it? VOL, right? The output low voltage. So in other words, for this inverter, VOL is not equal to zero. Right, no matter how much you increase the input voltage, the output voltage is not going to go to zero. What about VOH? VOH is VDD, right? Because at that point, the input is low, the NMOS is completely off. No current, therefore the output voltage is actually equal to VDD. It is not close to VDD, it is VDD. Okay? Barring of course some leakage currents and things of that sort, which we are ignoring anyway because they are much smaller than the other currents that we are interested in. Okay? So one important observation already is that VOL for this inverter is not equal to zero. Right? The VIH, VIL, etc. can be defined pretty much the same way that they were done for the NMOS, for the CMOS transistor, so I'm not going to go into that part. But VOL not being equal to zero raises another interesting problem for us. What if VOL, forget zero, it is not even low enough to go below VT. Okay, more time. What will happen then? Does it matter whether it goes below VT or not? This output of this inverter is going to be used as the input for some other gate. Okay, so that's why this becomes important. VT as such is not important for this transistor or for this inverter. But the output of this inverter is going to be used as the input for some other gate. So its output does not even go below VT. What it means is that the next gate can never be turned off properly. Okay? So the VOL value is important. Right? How small is the value of VOL that you get is an important characteristic of this transistor. Now, what are the things that determine VOL? Let's try and see if we can calculate the value of VOL. How would we calculate VOL? As usual, for anything that you have in this situation, you equate current, right? Under what condition? In the linear region, with input equal to? So input equal to VDD, you find out what is the current through the NMOS, what is the current through the resistor, make them equal to each other. Okay? So what is the current through the resistor anyway? VDD minus VO divided by R. Okay, this is the current through the resistor. And this must be equal to mu n C of Wn by Ln. Which region of operation is it in? Linear. So put in the equation for linear, right? VDS is equal to VO. So I can basically write VO over here. Into input is VDD minus VT minus VO by 2. Okay? So at the first cut, what I'm going to do is I'm going to neglect this VO by 2 term. Why is that a good, you know, safe thing to neglect? How much do you expect the value of VO to be? Ideally we expect it to be 0. If not 0, then at least it's going to be something close to 0, hopefully. Right? In any case, we want it to be less than VT for sure. Right? So whatever it is, this VO by 2 term is going to be smaller than VT and definitely much smaller than VDD minus VT. Okay? Clearly we are making an error by approximating VO by 2 to 0, but that error is not going to be very large. Okay. If you want, you can go ahead and of course compute the full quadratic. That will also give you an expression. It doesn't really matter because you have to keep in mind that this equation that we have over here is first of all an approximation to the current. Okay. Alright, so if I make that approximation, then what do I have? Okay. So VO by VDD is going to be something by something plus R. Okay? We can work out that expression out here. So what does this tell you? What should you choose the value of R to be? So this vector is telling you that the R should be high. Right? So you make the resistance high in order to get the VO to be as small as possible. Okay? Intuitively what it's telling you is you want that when the R is high, that output current which it takes for giving that delta V drop is going to be very small, so it can be supported by a very small value of VDS or VO. Okay? So this seems simple enough. It means that we can basically construct as high a resistance as possible, and based on that we'll get a, you know, as R tends to infinity, we'll get a more and more ideal characteristic. Okay. Now, what does the VTC look like when R tends to infinity? Will it be something which looks like this, or like this, or like this? Which of these shapes is most likely to be the one that you see as R tends to infinity? What happens as R becomes higher and higher for any given current that is there? The delta V is going to be large, right? Which means that the drop in the output voltage is going to be very sharp. So effectively it will end up being something like this. What's the drawback of this? What is the midpoint of switching threshold going to be like? Switching threshold is going to be much less than VDD by 2. Okay? Graphically at least what you can see is, in fact, it tends to become closer and closer to VT itself. Right? So the switching threshold is not very far from VT, and VT is around 0.4 volts. So it's quite far away from the 0.9 volts that we would like to see for the switching threshold. Okay? Which in turn means that the noise margin is going to be poor. Okay? The other problem with this kind of design is, how do I construct a large resistor? How do I make a large resistance value? Forget about integrated circuits for now, but how do I make a large resistor? Huh? What are the choices that I have? What are all the things I can do to make a large value of resistor? Reduce the area of cross section of whatever is the conducting wire. Right? So you reduce the area of cross section, that's fine. Increase the length or change the resistivity. Okay? So those are the three options that I really have in order to make the resistor larger. Working with an integrated circuit process, a VLSI process, which means that we cannot just choose any arbitrary material that we want. We have to choose something that is available to us in the process. Same way, I cannot just choose any arbitrary area of cross section that I want. It has to follow the design rules of that process. Okay. So the parameter among these three that is most easily in my control is going to be the length. Okay. The others can be controlled to some extent. I can see if there are available higher resistivity materials and try and use those. Same way, I can minimize the area of cross section. I can go to minimum width. I can't go below that. Right? The 2 lambda or whatever is the minimum size of any conducting material, I cannot go below that. Okay? But the length I can change. I can increase it as much as I want. So usually the most common method would be to increase L as much as possible in order to get a large value of resistance. Okay? Now what does that mean for the layout? What's the layout going to look like? You have already done the layout of a CMOS inverter, right? So it will have some VDD ground. Apart from that, it will have some area over here where there is a NMOS transistor and something out here where you will have to have a resistor, right? How do I make it long? I will have to make some kind of structure like this. Something is sort of weaves back and forth, serpentine shape. Right? That's the only way really that within a finite amount of area I can fit in a longer length. Okay, subject to all my design rule constraints. Otherwise, it's just going to become larger and larger than what I can accept. Okay? So this business of getting a large enough value for R is also a tricky problem as far as this kind of inverter is concerned. Right? Now finally there is one more problem associated with these kind of inverters. Consider what happens when Vi is equal to VDD. There will be some current that is flowing through. How much is that current? It is going to be determined by the NMOS characteristic and this resistance itself. Okay? What happens when you have the voltage source VDD and a constant current flowing out of it? There is dissipation of power. Okay? So constant current means constant dissipation of power. What do I mean by dissipation of power? It's just that that current is flowing through a resistor and then through the NMOS transistor. And then going to ground, it's lost, right? Which means that during that time while it's going there is going to be some I square R heating through the resistor and whatever some delta V, that VO into I across the NMOS transistor itself. Both of them are going to heat up, right? Because there's a constant current flowing through them. Is such a situation there in the case of the static CMOS? This is one of the most important points of CMOS, right? I did not mention it at the time when we were initially considering CMOS inverters, but it was one of the reasons why CMOS, even though you have to have those extra PMOS transistors instead of just having a single NMOS transistor over here, for an inverter it does not matter too much, but for something like a NOR gate or something of that sort, that extra PMOS can become quite significant. Right? In spite of that, people are willing to go with the extra transistors required over there and go with CMOS simply because it has zero static power dissipation. Zero or close to zero. The reason I am saying close to zero is because especially as we go nowadays into smaller and smaller technology, the leakage current that is flowing, even when the PMOS is supposed to be off, can be fairly significant. Okay? Significant meaning it's not going to be in the microampere range, but still not as small as we would like it to be. Over here on the other hand, this could very well be in the microampere range itself, the static current. Right? Because typical values for R would be somewhere in the kilo ohms or tens of kilo ohms range, which means that several microamps easily is going to be flowing through this resistor and NMOS transistor. Okay? So static power dissipation is one of the major problems as far as this kind of inverter is concerned. Okay? This is generally referred to as a resistive load NMOS. For obvious reasons, right? The load that is there on the NMOS transistor is a resistor. Why do we call it the load? Because that is what is connected at our output terminal and is determining what is the final output that we achieve based on whatever input that we get. Okay? In the CMOS, the load was another CMOS transistor. Whereas over here it is a resistor that is being used as the load, hence the term resistive load NMOS. Okay? So, what are the things that we can see? Clearly, so far we have seen a number of drawbacks. Static power dissipation, difficult to create large value of R, the fact that VOL is not equal to 0, right? All of those are disadvantages. Are there any advantages at all for this? Lesser number of transistors. What is one impact of lesser number of transistors that you can think of? Capacitance, right? This circuit is going to be connected to the output of some gate, right? When it's connected to the output of some gate, that gate has to drive the capacitance on this circuit. Okay? If there is only one NMOS instead of an NMOS and a PMOS, the capacitive load offered by the circuit is lower. So that's one advantage over here. The resistor is there, but look at what's connected to the input. The resistor is not connected to the input at all. Okay. Whereas in the CMOS, the input is connected to both terminals. Right? So the capacitance is large. Apart from that, the resistance is a conducting material at the end of the day. It will not have the same level of capacitance as the MOSFET. Okay. So even though it does have a significant area being covered under it, the total capacitance of that area will be less than that of a equivalent transistor. So even the parasitic over here will actually be less. Okay? So the capacitive load that it offers will be lower. The second possible advantage of this is when you go for something like a NOR gate. So what does a two input NOR gate in this technology look like? I have this resistor and these two pull down NMOS. Okay? the same register as before. I don't have to really change that. Right? Because in the worst case, any one of these NMOS transistors has to be able to pull it down. That's all that I really care about. Okay? But now, instead of having two CMOS transistors which would have been stacked together in series and therefore would have been of size 4A. Right? I have only one resistor instead. So there is a potential saving in space. Okay? That of course depends on the exact values of the transistors and resistors etc. that are chosen. Okay? So these are a couple of possible advantages of this kind of technology. Right? Now, one important point over here is what I mentioned already, the value of VOL, the output low voltage, depends on the choice of R. Okay. In particular, it depends on how big is R compared to the size of the NMOS transistor. Okay, if the NMOS transistor is bigger, it will do a better job of pulling down more current. Okay. So then the value of R that you choose will also vary correspondingly in order to get a given value of VOL. Okay, so if that is the case, what we are saying is the final behavior depends on the ratio of sizes R versus WN by L. Okay, so W by L of the NMOS transistor is one point to be considered. The value of R is another. Okay, and the relative ratio between those is going to determine how this circuit behaves. Okay. So this kind of logic in general is called the ratioed logic. Why? Because the functionality, the very fact that whether it behaves as an inverter or not, depends on a ratio. The ratio between the size of the resistor and that of the transistor. Okay? The relative size of that resistor and that transistor determine whether or not this will even behave as an inverter. Not of how good an inverter is. Not of how fast it switches, how good the VM value is or anything of that sort. But even whether or not it behaves as an inverter is determined by this ratio. Okay? The basic functionality itself is determined by that ratio. Not just the performance. Okay? Alright, so that with that, let's move on to another very similar kind of logic family. Here, instead of the resistor, so we already saw that there was a problem with building this resistor, right? How do you construct it? You need to have a fairly high resistivity material, it needs to be long, etc., etc. Okay? Why did we even go with that resistor thing? Because the input capacitance decreases and for gates like the NOR gate, the overall area might also reduce. Okay? So instead, I would like to look for another option, a different kind of load which allows me to have the same advantages without having to worry too much about the area problem. Okay? What we do for that is as follows. So far it looks similar to CMOS, right? Because I have a CMOS as well as an NMOS. The only difference that I am going to make is, instead of connecting the input to the CMOS transistor, I just ground the input of the CMOS transistor. Okay? So what happens when I ground the input of a CMOS transistor and its source is connected to VDD? What region of operation is it in? Is it ever going to be in cutoff? So it's never going to be in cutoff because VGS is always equal to VDD in this case. Magnitude of VGS is equal to VDD. Okay? Whether it's in cutoff or saturation depends on the value of VDS, that is the VO. Okay? Now, what happens when input is low? When input is low, what happens to the output? It's going to get pulled up. Why? Because the NMOS is off. If the output was some low voltage, then current will flow through the PMOS into that output. Okay? Up to what point? At what point will it stop conducting? Why will it stop conducting? Because there is a VGS which is always positive, right? Will it stop before VDD or will it go all the way to VDD? So, see, as far as the PMOS, think about how the PMOS also works, right? When there is a VGS across it, the VDS can drop all the way to zero. Right? Current will continue to flow until the VDS drops all the way to zero. Once it becomes zero, it will stop conducting. So the output will go all the way up to VDD. Right? What happens as the input increases? As the input slowly increases, at some point I cross the threshold voltage of the NMOS. At that point, both transistors are on. The PMOS has VGS equal to VDD. The NMOS has VGS equal to VI. Okay? Now it becomes a fight between them to determine what is the output voltage. But eventually, we can be sure that the output voltage will start dropping. Finally, for large enough values of VI, right, I will get the output going to some output low which will not be 0. Why will it not be 0? Because the PMOS and the NMOS will both be conducting. The PMOS is trying to pull the output up, the NMOS is trying to pull the output down. Okay? And balancing between these two is finally going to give me a value of VOL. Okay? So, first thing, even more clearly than in the case of the resistive load, we can see that this is going to be a ratioed logic. It straight away WP versus WN. That is the width of the premolars versus the width of the end-molars, which is going to determine at what point I start pulling down the VTC and what is the final value to which the VOL goes. Right? In general, the end-molars has to be stronger than the premolars. What do I mean by stronger? For a given value of VGS, it has to be able to take larger amount of current, right? So that, or rather, or conversely, for a given current, it has to require a smaller value of VDS across it. Right? Only then the output VDS is finally going to be low, because at that time both the transistors, CMOS as well as NMOS, have a high value of VDS across it. Under those conditions, I want the output to be low. So intuitively, what we can see is the NMOS has to be stronger than the PMOS, capable of delivering larger current for a given voltage. Okay? Which means that the ratio cannot be 2:1. Right? Because if I have a 2:1 ratio between WT and WN, then they'll balance out perfectly. And what I would have got is, with both transistors completely on, I would have got the output voltage to be VDD by 2. Which is not good, because it is not below threshold voltage. Okay? So usually you want WT to be even smaller than that. Or alternatively, you have to make WN larger than minimum size. Okay? But the one thing that is cleared is, clear over here is, this is ratio. It depends on the ratio of the sizes of WP and WN. Right? Other than that, okay, so by the way, this family of logic is called pseudo NMOS. Okay? It's because the typical resistive load that I told you earlier is usually called NMOS logic. Okay? You don't usually say resistive load NMOS logic, even just NMOS logic usually refers to that. This is pseudo NMOS because instead of a resistor, a PMOS transistor is used. Okay? What about its characteristics? Does it have static power dissipation? Yes. Because when the input is high, both the PMOS as well as the NMOS are conducting. Static current is flowing from VDD to ground. So that's a waste of current. When the input is high, there is static power. Only when the input is high, when the input is low for both this as well as NMOS, when input is low, there is no current flowing through. So there is no power dissipation. Right? But when the input is high, there is power dissipation. What about the area? Is this also a problem like the resistor? No, you have actually solved that problem. Right? So in this case especially, when you have the NOR kind of structure, this can be significantly more efficient to implement than either the resistive load NMOS or the CMOS circuit. Okay? It becomes even more interesting when you have multiple input NORs. Okay? And one thing which you will probably look at much later is, there are some kinds of circuits especially used for address decoders in memory banks or in register files, right? In fact, you remember the problem that we took up for logical effort, right? Where we said we wanted to create a 4-input NAND gate because that would be the address decoder for a register file. You can do something similar with NOR gate. right? It would be active low instead of active high, right? But you could sort of say that the NOR gate can be used as an address decoder. Right? Only when all the inputs are 0 will the output be 1. Okay? If you want to create such decoders, this kind of logic is extremely efficient for it. It is much better than the kind of large CMOS based NOR gates that you would create. Okay? Alright, so like I said, this is pseudo NMOS. This is yet another logic family. The third one which is of interest is saying, okay, now we have this problem of in both cases the resistive load as well as the PMOS, that is the pseudo NMOS. Our output does not go from rail to rail, that is it does not go from VDD to zero. The output high goes to VDD but output low does not go to zero. Okay? And there are some issues with it basically that we would like to fix. So is there any way by which we can correct this? And one proposal which was given for correcting this without going to CMOS is to say, let's look at a different kind of logic. Some structure which looks something like this. So what is this structure? It looks more complicated, right? What we have over here is effectively two pull down networks. And as far as the pull up is concerned, instead of having a full array of PMOS transistors, we have only two PMOS transistors. But those PMOS are now connected in such a way that they are essentially sort of back to back, and so two inverters have been connected back to back. Okay? They are connected up in such a way that the output of one is connected to the input of the other and vice versa. Okay? Now what is the point of this? Why are we doing something of this sort? The idea over here is we want to get some of the advantages of something like pseudo NMOS, but at the same time we want to get the full rail to rail swing and also see whether there are any other advantages that we can get on the side. Okay? Obviously there will be some disadvantages as well. We'll have to look at those and understand what is the disadvantage, what is the advantage, and finally whether this is useful for us. Okay? Alright, I'll stop here for now. Next time we'll continue with this logic as well as a couple of other things. That next class will be on Friday. Tomorrow is the quiz. Please follow the department schedule to find out in which room you are supposed to be seated. The time is going to be the regular quiz time. So we are following the institute schedule completely.